निशान तू ही खुद राज़े मोहब्बत तू मोहब्बत की जुबान है तेरी आवाज़ में उसने बहारे जिंदगी हम तो जन्नत भी न लेंगे तेरी खातिर मेहरबान
हिमालय The snow-clad mountains of the Himalayas, the highest mountain ranges of the world, leave us spellbound in admiration of this celestial work of nature. Himalayas, the abode of snow and the home of the gods and goddesses. The melting snow glides down the mountain sides into rippling rivers of ice-cold waters. These rivers in turn color the hills and dales into numerous shades of green. The greenest and the most beautiful of them all is the valley of Kashmir. Kashmir, the paradise on earth. The Mughal Emperor Jahangir in a couplet sang, If there be a paradise on earth, it is here, it is here, it is here. Kashmir was once a large pond known as Satisat. A demon who terrorized the neighborhood lived in this pond. Rishi Kashyap, with the help of Brahma and other gods, made holes in the hills around the pond and thus drained out the water and destroyed the demon. It is believed that this area was named Kashmir after the name of its savior, Rishi Kashyap, and the name continues till today. Kashmir territory starts from the northern plains of Punjab around Jammu and comprises of Baltistan, Dardastan, Muzaffarabad, Mirpur, Poonch, Ladakh and the valley of Kashmir. Russia, Pakistan and China border Kashmir. Kashmir was an important watering place for caravans moving to and from Central Asia to India. The natural beauty of Kashmir attracted all types of people, poets, painters, philosophers, kings and rulers. But the original inhabitants of Kashmir were Aryans. From 1006 AD, the earliest history of Kashmir can be found in poet Kalhan's Raj Tarangini. The living evidence of such an ancient history is the Khir Bhavani temple. Legends have it that Maharagini Devi was flown by Hanumanji on the back of Anantnag from Sri Lanka to Srinagar as instructed by Lord Sri Ram. Believers experience a feeling of unique solace here. History is mute witness to the price Kashmir paid time and again to preserve its heavenly beauty. Many ruled Kashmir and went their way, leaving behind an imprint of their own culture and ethos, the assimilation of which led Kashmir to a unique character of its own. These ruins speak volumes of their earlier splendor. Parihaspur was an important center in ancient times. Hindus and Buddhist religious symbols found here are today indicative of this fact. Ashoka the Great fell to the charms of the valley when he came to crush the rebels in Takshila. It is said that it was he who built Srinagar. Raja Lalitra Aditya of Karkot dynasty was the greatest Hindu ruler of Kashmir. Martin Temple, also known as Sun Temple, was built during the Karkot regime and is the oldest temple of North India. During this period, a new capital town of Avantipur was also established by Raja Avantivarman of Karkot dynasty. Ancient monuments and idols found all over Kashmir established the fact that many diverse religions coexisted in the past. Even today, Kashmir is steadfastly following this tradition and shall forever continue to do so. Sankracharya Temple also came up during the reign of Karkot. To preach Sanatan Dharma, Jagadguru Shankaracharya himself traveled to Kashmir from the south. A sojourn in Kashmir without a visit to these temples seems an incomplete proposition. Obeisance to Vaishno Devi temple also seems to be a must for all visitors. Muslims had started settling in India. They used to visit Malabar for trade and commerce and slowly started living there. Gradually, they moved to Gujarat and then to Kashmir. Islam was spreading because of its message of peace and amiability. The history of Kashmir turned a new page when a Muslim Jagirdar, Shah Mir, founded the Sultan dynasty, which ruled for about 222 years. In memory of a religious preacher, Mir Sayyid Ali, who came from Iran during the reign of Sultan Qutubuddin, this holy mosque was built by Shah Hamdan. Charar Sharif is located 26 kilometers away from Srinagar. This has equal religious sanctity for both Hindus and Muslims. Sheikh Nuruddin, whose remains are enshrined here, was also known as Nandrishi. Zainul Abidin was the most famous ruler of Sultan dynasty, who encouraged the craft of shawls and rugs weaving. To acquire proficiency in this art, he sent weavers to Iran for training. Sikh religion also made inroads by this time in Kashmir. Patthar Sahab Gurdwara, situated on a secluded pathway to Leh, is a very holy Shri shrine. Every person passing this way pays homage with deep faith in the heart. Guru Nanak had liberated the people from the tyranny of a demon by slaying him there. The Chakra dynasty followed the Sultan dynasty. Kashmir suffered a lot due to internal squabblings and infighting of these rulers. As a result, people pleaded to the Mughal Emperor Akbar to take over the administration of Kashmir. Thus, Kashmir became a part of the Mughal Empire. A new era of happiness and prosperity dawned.
इस बागे इरम का क्या कहना जन्नत का नजारा हर सू है हर फूल का बुना रंग जुदा हर फूल की अपनी खुशबू है
and artisans received encouragement and patronage. Beautiful handicrafts of Kashmir created a market for themselves all over the world. Pashmina and Chartreuse reached France through Egypt. It is said that Queen Josephine, Napoleon's royal consort, had 400 Kashmiri shawls. Islam had influenced the people of Kashmir greatly, but simultaneously both Hindu and Sikh religions were equally respected and practiced. There was no communal discord. Each religion had blended and influenced the diverse cultures harmoniously. Especially Hindus and Muslims accepted and practiced each other's culture and tradition. Diversity could not divide the people. This period of our country's history was a period of love, togetherness, integrity, coexistence, peace, prosperity and progress. Indeed, a golden era in all its glory.
وزرني والمكذبين أولي النعمة ومهلهم قليلا إن لدينا أنكالا وجحيما وطعاما ذا غصة وعذابا أليما.
اعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الله اكبر الله اكبر
الله اكبر
الله اكبر الله اكبر
الله اكبر الله اكبر
कश्मीर की मेरी कहानी तुम सुनो ये दास्तां कश्मीर की ये दास्तां कश्मीर की
Mughal emperors ruled Kashmir for many generations. But towards the beginning of the 18th century, the authority over Kashmir declined. The Sikh ruler, Raja Ranjit Singh, established a sovereignty over Kashmir. Maharaja Ranjit Singh had a dominating personality and tactfully kept his subjects under control. In spite of all this, the Sikh domination lasted for hardly 50 years. After Ranjit Singh, Kashmir was sold for a paltry sum of 65 lakh rupees to the Dogri king Gulab Singh. Rumours are that Gulab Singh was sweet-tongued, ambitious, a deceiver and very selfish. But it is said that in him Kashmir found a strong ruler after centuries. a ruler who established some administration. With the help of his commander-in-chief, Zarawar Singh, Gulab Singh expanded his kingdom up to Ladakh, plundering the conquered regions was common in those days, but Zarawar Singh did not do so. For the first time in history, Kashmir reached its natural boundaries. Ranbir Singh succeeded his father, Gulab Singh. Then Pratap Singh acceded to the throne of Kashmir. As he did not have a male heir, he handed over the reins of the kingdom to his nephew, Hari Singh. It was at this time that every Indian was yearning to join the freedom struggle. This passion had by now reached Kashmir. 1947 was the year of our Quit Kashmir struggle, when thousands of young and old raised their voice against the rule of the Maharaja. Our voice reached the whole of India, especially Pandit Nehru, the Congress and other organizations which supported and guided us. Under this pressure, the Maharaja released Sheikh Sahib, who had been imprisoned under the charges of revolt.
खासकर पंडित नेहरू और कांग्रेस ने और दूसरी जमातों ने हमारी हिमायत की तहरीक की उसके मजबूर होकर महाराज ने शेख साहब को भी रिहा किया जिनके खिलाफ बगावत का इल्जाम था और हमारी भी रिहाई.
शेख अब्दुल्ला could now be openly heard. He called for the formation of an elected government. He also raised the Quit Kashmir slogan against Raja Hari Singh. India was divided in 1947. The Muslims of Kashmir did not want the nation to be divided on communal lines. They opposed the division of the country. Muhammad Ali Jinnah pressurized the National Conference to put Kashmir in the Pakistani bag. In spite of the pressures, the National Conference did not change its stand. Jinnah then tried his last weapon. He blocked the road by which Kashmir got its daily requirement of food, petrol and other essentials. Even salt could not reach Kashmir. The tribals of the frontier province are notorious for ambushing, looting and murder. Using them, along with the Pakistani army, Jinnah invaded Kashmir. As far as Jammu Kashmir was concerned, the Maharaja made an agreement with the newly created states, and the people were left wondering what could happen to Kashmir. These Kabalis launched their first offensive on Muzaffarabad, which is about 30 miles from Uri. They looted and murdered their own Kashmiri Muslim brothers. Their properties were burned and their wives molested. This definitely is not the teaching of Islam. Islam teaches peace and harmony. This barbarism was taught to them by the Pakistanis, who were bent upon expanding their territorial boundaries. Maharaja Hari Singh ordered the army under the command of Brigadier Rajendra Singh to repel the invaders. Brigadier Rajendra Singh's army established camp on the banks of the rivulet. The bridge was blown up to stop the advancing Kabalis. The Kabalis got off their trucks and started wading the rivulet. Brigadier Rajendra Singh launched a massive attack. The Brigadier's army succeeded in stopping them for a while. But because of the enemy's much larger number, Brigadier Rajendra Singh had to retreat. In this battle, he sacrificed his life for the country. He was awarded India's first Mahavir Chakra for his gallantry in action. To achieve their fiendish and un-Islamic designs, the Kabilis increased the looting and destruction all around. In those days, there were only one powerhouse in Mahuja, which was situated in between Baramulla and Uri. The Kabilis attacked and destroyed the powerhouse. The whole of Srinagar was plunged into darkness. The people became panicky. That night, Maharaja Sahib made his exit. All his goods and treasures were loaded on military trucks and he moved to Jammu. The kingdom collapsed. There was none to save Kashmir. All the doors had opened for the Kabilis. Addressing a mammoth congregation at the Shahi Masjid, Sheikh Sahib said that it is now for us to get weapons from where we can. He called upon the people to protect their religion and their country at all costs.
Unki appeal ka ye asar tha ki sham ko hum ek chota sa group leke ek kulhara kisi ke paas koi danda koi jo kuch jahan se mila hum march karte chale gaye aur sham tak pure shahar mein yahi pattern hone laga.
By evening, the whole city got the news that a militia of about 10,000 volunteers had been formed along with the formation of a peace brigade. The duty of the peace brigade was to maintain internal peace and order. It was the duty of the militia to keep a close watch on the movement of the invaders and to check their advance wherever and whenever possible so that they may not enter the villages for looting and plundering.
जहाँ मुमकिन हो सके उनके एडवांस को रोकना ताकि गांव में घुसके रूमर्स फैलना के साहब फौज तैयार है और हिफाज के लिए पक्के इंतजाम.
As far as the Kashmiri women were concerned, when they heard that the Kabili raiders were looting and plundering from Muzaffarabad to Baramulla, they too united and joined the battle along with their sons, husbands and brothers. They organized themselves in different ways. One of them was to receive rifle training. Women's Defense Corps was established.
और कश्मीरी औरतों ने मुख्तलिफ तरीकों से अपने आप को मुनज़्ज़म किया. एक तरीका ये अपनाया कि हम खुद भी बंदूक की ट्रेनिंग हासिल करें और वुमेन डिफेंस कोर का कयाम अमल में आया. इसमें मोहतरमा ज़ैनब बेगम, महमूद अहमद अली शाह, मैं और मेरे साथ कई और सैकड़ों बहनें और माएँ शामिल हुई.
She is Sajida Begum. She soon became an expert in rifle shooting and with the people of Kashmir marched out to intercept the Kabilis.
Thank you.
At that time, I remember, on the 27th or 28th October, we went inside the stadium cinema, where the headquarters of the National Conference were situated. Our names were noted down and arms were issued to us. We were enrolled into groups or parties. In the valley there is an area called Taral. This area has a large population of Sikhs. There were rumors that the people there were quite panicky. Our first group was sent to Taral. For 3, 4 or 5 days, we went from village to village and talked to the people. The panic was greatly reduced. The minority community of Kashmiri Pandits, the Khatri traders of Rawalpindi, and the Sikh community united with Sheikh Sahib. They visited every lane and by lane and went from door to door. Afterwards, Sheikh Sahib went to Delhi. Sheikh Abdullah advised the Indian government to send the troops immediately and save Kashmir. Time was running out. The Kabilis, like a tempest wave, had reached Baramulla. Looting and plundering was in full swing. There was fire all around. Even the sacred precincts of Saint Joseph could not escape these terrible ravagers. Even to this day, Sister Priscilla shudders at the very thought of that horrifying day.
So we take our precaution to receive those people in peace, thinking in the hospital they would not be attacked. But it was not like that. They come in here inside, shooting, shouting, breaking. This was like war. So we were minded for the church, we were fighting the church. They destroyed completely the church inside. Their intention, as we come to know, was to loot and to kill. And when they, I find the people, they were a little go far, I came out from the room thinking our sister was there in the veranda. And what I find, the boat were down line bleeding. The superior and the assistant. Far away was a nurse, a girl, who was dead.
This church, this house of God, was in the possession of the devils for a few hours. The Kabilis sprang like a gale of storm, looted, ransacked and killed. Poonj and Rajouri areas were also surrounded by the Kabilis. Those few days of Rajouri are a blot on the whole human race. The Kabilis attacked at night. By dawn, more than half the town had been destroyed. Those who escaped took shelter in the Tehsil courtroom. They tried their best to protect themselves. Whatever ammunition or explosives they had was finished. There was no escape. Death was apparent. Overpowering all emotions, they killed their wives and children with their own hands and gave them an honorable death. And then, staking their own lives, marched towards Jawahar Nagar.
Oh.
happened in just 5 days, the most crucial ones in the history of Kashmir. National Conference workers like Maqbool Sherwani and Master Najib were able to mislead the Kabalis and their leaders, who were actually officers of the Pakistani army.
कबाइलियों और उनके लीडर्स और उनके थे सात साल आर्मी के ऑफिसर उनको उन्होंने गुमराह किया और कहा कि साहब उन्हें अगर पूरी तरह से वहाँ डिफेंस लगा दिया हमारा जो फोर्स में आप जरा अपने आप को कंसोलिडेट करिए.
Maqbool Sherwani was captured by the Kabalis and was forced to reveal the hideouts of the Sikhs, but he, with great presence of mind, misguided them. When the enemy realized that in spite of being a Muslim, Maqbool Sherwani had frustrated their plans, he was brutally done to death. A national conference took control of the situation, and there was not a single incident of any atrocity on any non-Muslim either in the city or the entire valley. In spite of the martyrdom of the Kashmiris for their motherland, the situation in Kashmir was deteriorating. The Maharaja of Kashmir decided to be with India and signed the accession deed. The deed was drawn as per the international laws and regulations. Sajida Begum aptly describes the solitary signature of the Maharaja as the real will of the whole of the Kashmiri people. With this, the Indian Air Force started ferrying the Indian army to Kashmir. And we witnessed the magnificent scene of multitudes of men, women and children applauding enthusiastically from the rooftops, welcoming the Indian troops. Mir Nasrura remembered the landing of the 1st Sikh Regiment, which was led to Lal Chowk. The Sikh Regiment, under the command of Colonel Ranjit Rai, advanced towards Baramulla and was engaged with the Kabalis in a fierce encounter in which Colonel Ranjit Rai lost his life. For his valor, Colonel Ranjit Rai was awarded the Mahavir Chakra. The Kabalis intruded as far as Budgam, and security of Srinagar Airport was in jeopardy. The airport was a deciding factor in the outcome of this war. Major Somnath Sharma of 4th Command and his platoon, in spite of the heavy odds, destroyed most of the enemy units before laying down their own lives. Major Somnath Sharma sacrificed himself for the motherland. He was honored with the Paramveer Chakra, the highest award for bravery. In Poonch Rajouri, the Kabalis had unleashed a reign of terror and anarchy. Ishwari Devi Maini, who survived the nightmare, narrates, "The Kabalis attacked us from all four sides, and about 40 to 50,000 of us, including people from the neighboring districts, entered Poonch as refugees." There was an acute shortage of food in Poonch, and all of us were almost dying of starvation. Poonch was virtually under siege, and nothing could enter or leave the town. We all decided to snatch the food from the intruders themselves. I masqueraded as a mounted soldier and charged out on a steed, challenging the enemy to follow me if they had the guts. While the days passed with great difficulty, a unit of the Indian Army was making efforts to liberate Poonch. Under the command of Brigadier Sen, the unit was dispatched, but it was surrounded by the enemy lines. Colonel Pritam Singh reached Poonch with great difficulty to extend support to the besieged unit. Brigadier Pritam Singh, on reaching Poonch, found it swarming with the enemy, and there was no food for either our civilians or our army. We decided to make another airstrip at the aerodrome. At the cost of many precious lives, an airstrip was laid. In spite of heavy enemy bombing, Commodore Meher Singh landed at great risk with a plane full of food to feed the starving people of Poonch. On realizing that our security forces were less in number at Jangad, enemy forces doubled their strength and captured it. Our soldiers were camping at Naushera, but the enemy intruded there also. In a clever maneuver, Brigadier Usman outwitted the enemy at Kot on 10th February. Brigadier Usman, however, paid heavily for this victory with his life. He had always said, "All of us are mortals, but there could be no death more honorable than the one which comes while one is defending the honor, history, and heritage of one's motherland." Gradually, the Indian Army pushed back the intruders. Seven tanks reached the barren heights of Zozila, traversing the 8.5 mile long mountainous path which was laid out in merely 27 days. Lieutenant Colonel Sparrow and his men captured Zozila in a blinding blizzard. The prisoners of war and the arms and ammunition abandoned by the fleeing intruders indicated beyond doubt the Pakistani army's involvement in this operation. With such obvious evidence in hand, Nehru, who believed in peace and non-violence, appealed to the United Nations for justice. Pakistan refuted all allegations and attributed the whole armed attack to an uprising of the Kabalis. International journalists, however, covering the attack, clearly exposed the Pakistani army's involvement in the operations. These newsreel clippings, shot by cameramen of other countries, clearly show the Pakistani army in Kashmir. Are these modern and sophisticated weapons the handiwork of primitive Kabilis? The British commander-in-chief of the Pakistani army himself led the Kabilis. When Pakistan could no longer deny such obvious facts, it admitted that its armed forces were involved in the Kashmir war. The Security Council passed the following resolution: Pakistan to withdraw its forces from the entire territories of the state of Jammu and Kashmir. The Pakistan-occupied Kashmir forces would be disarmed and disbanded. The northern areas would revert for administration to the government of the state and for defense to the government of India. India and Pakistan agreed to a ceasefire, but Pakistan, instead of vacating the illegally occupied territory, went a step further and encroached upon certain areas of northern Kashmir. Pakistan continues to defy the Security Council's resolution to this day. The relationship between the people of Kashmir, the people of the rest of India, and the Indian Army is not something skin deep, but is very deep rooted and one of total faith. Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru visited Kashmir to a warm reception at Lal Chowk after the accession deed was signed. Sheikh Abdullah said that the Kashmiris and the rest of the countrymen belonged to each other. Kashmir, the paradise on earth, which had turned into a terror-stricken hell, had regained its peace and tranquility. Whatever was destroyed in the war was to be rebuilt. The army which had defended this valley with its blood was now engaged in this task of rehabilitation. Army personnel in Kashmir came out of their cantonments to be part of civilian life. These military people blended into the mainstream of history, culture and language, which holds together the whole diverse spectrum of Kashmiri life. In spite of the impediments engineered by Pakistan, the Indian government spared none of its efforts toward the prosperity of Kashmir. The doors of Kashmir occupied by Pakistan are shut to everyone, while our Kashmir welcomes with open arms visitors from the world over. The government of India and the army gave priority to the rebuilding of the deteriorated roads, which are so essential for the smooth flow of men and material. Not realizing the importance of forestry, many areas were denuded of their wealth,
But the government, along with the army, commenced on a war footing the afforestation programs, not only in Kashmir, but also in Ladakh. This resulted in regular monsoons in Ladakh, previously a dry region. One could at one time count the schools and hospitals on one's fingertips. But plans were implemented to open many more schools and hospitals in the cities and remote far-flung areas. Prosperity and progress of Kashmir could not be tolerated by Pakistan, and in 1965, Pakistani soldiers masquerading as Kabalis infiltrated into Kashmir to spread chaos and anarchy and to finally capture it. Muhammad Din was shepherding his sheep when accidentally he came across some gun-toting foreign troublemakers. I was captured by them and they asked me the whereabouts of our army personnel. He fooled them and brought them to the notice of our army, who arrested them. The Pakistani infiltrators had come expecting the Indian Muslims to support them in their wild hope of capturing Kashmir. But repeating the history of 1947, the Indian Muslims once again smashed their hopes to pieces. Muhammad Din was awarded the Padma Shri for his patriotism. For a similar action of valor and patriotism, Malibi of Kunjki Mandi village was honored. Some Pakistani infiltrators took shelter in Malibi's house. Risking her own life, she got them arrested. In another instance, Pyaru Ram held the army personnel at considerable risk to his own person in a heavy firing exchange.
लाखों को पानी का बंदोबस्त करो साहब उस वक्त फिर गोलाबाजी शुरू दूसरा दिन हो गया तो साहब उस वक्त माल विदेशी दुनिया भाग रही थी हम साहब नहीं भागे और पानी पजाया और अमनिशन पजाया और जान फिकर नहीं मखिया मर जाएंगे फौज के साथ मरेंगे
The paramilitary soldiers of India were instrumental in flushing out Pakistani warmongers from their hideouts. Arms manufactured in Pakistan were seized. Once again, Pakistani army in the guise of Kabalis had infiltrated to terrorize and disturb the peace of the valley. Haji Pir Pass was the easiest route to enter Kashmir for the Pakistani infiltrators. The Indian army captured it and maintained a strict and constant vigil on this vulnerable area.
India,
कश्मीर की मेरी जुबानी तुम सुनो ये दास्तां कश्मीर की ये दास्तां कश्मीर की
सैतालीस के बाद पहली बार भारत निवासियों को पता चला कि पाकिस्तानी कश्मीर के बाशिंदों की हालत इतनी खराब है कि उनको कफन का कपड़ा भी हासिल नहीं था और वो उसकी जगह आम काला कपड़ा इस्तेमाल करते थे।
कफन की बहुत कमी रहती थी, कई लोग ऐसा काला कफन लगाते थे जो ना इस्तेमाल था।
हाजी पीर की दरगाह वीरान पड़ी थी, भारतीय फौजी उसकी देखरेख करने लगी और मकामी बाशिंदों की भी उन्होंने हर तरह से मदद की। जब पाकिस्तानी गोरिल्ला कोशिश नाकाम रही तो वहां के फौजी हुक्मरानों ने यह तय किया कि झंब की अंतरराष्ट्रीय सरहद पार करके भारत पर हमला कर दिया जाए। भारतीय फौजों ने घमसान की जंग की। पाकिस्तानी एयरफोर्स ने सिविल जगहों को भी अपना निशाना बनाया, जिनमें जम्मू में जोरिया की मस्जिद भी शामिल है। जम्मू और कश्मीर के मुसलमानों को इससे बड़ा धक्का लगा और उन्होंने पाकिस्तानी हमले की बड़ी निंदा की। कश्मीरी आवाम की हमदर्दी में प्रधानमंत्री श्री लाल बहादुर शास्त्री ने कहा,
कश्मीर पर हमला किया जा रहा है और मैं जानता हूं कि पाकिस्तान को उसको बहाने का उसका पूरा इरादा है, तो एक सरकार के नाते हमारा क्या जवाब हो सकता है सिवाय इसके कि हम हथियारों का जवाब हथियारों से दें।
अमेरिका ने भारत को बार बार विश्वास दिलाया था कि उसके दिए हुए जंगी साजो सामान पाकिस्तान भारत के खिलाफ कभी इस्तेमाल नहीं करेगा, लेकिन पाकिस्तान ने सेबर जेट हवाई जहाजों से भारत पर हमले किए जिनको भारत ने भारी तादाद में तबाह किया। पाकिस्तान के इस दावे को कि वो दिल्ली तक पहुंच जाएगा 3 दिन के अंदर ही भारत ने खोखला कर दिया। अमेरिका के दिए हुए पैटर्न टैंकों का खेमकरण में भारत ने कब्रिस्तान बना दिया। कंपनी क्वार्टरमास्टर हवालदार अब्दुल हमीद ने 3 पैटर्न टैंक बर्बाद कर दिए। शहीद होने से पहले टैंकों का एक किला उन्होंने ढा दिया। उनको बहादुरी का सबसे बड़ा सम्मान परमवीर चक्र अता किया गया। बड़ी तेजी से बढ़ते हुए भारत की फौजों ने लाहौर से 15 किलोमीटर दूर इचोगिल नहर के किनारे डेरा डाल दिया।
फौजों को बुरी तरह हारता देखकर पाकिस्तान ने यूनाइटेड नेशंस को पुकारा, जहां भारत के प्रतिनिधि जस्टिस मोहम्मद करीम छागला ने कहा,
एंड आई एश्योर यू दैट दिस पर्टिकुलर कॉन्फ्लिक्ट दैट इज गोइंग ऑन इज अ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट नॉट ऑफ अवर मेकिंग. वी हैव टू रेजिस्ट विद आर्म्स पाकिस्तान्स एग्रेशन. इट इज प्योरली फॉर द पर्पस ऑफ सेल्फ डिफेंस.
दोनों मुल्क जंग रोकने पर राजी हो गए. जंग के गलत कदम उठाने पर 6,000 से ज्यादा पाकिस्तानी सिपाही मारे गए. पाकिस्तान का बेहिसाब जंगी साजो सामान तबाह हो गया और पंजाब के कई इलाकों से उसे हाथ धोना पड़ा. सोवियत यूनियन की दावत पर हमारे प्रधानमंत्री श्री लाल बहादुर शास्त्री पाकिस्तान के राष्ट्रपति अयूब खान से बातचीत करने ताशकंद गए.
Peace is vital for both India and Pakistan, and indeed for the world as a whole. It should be our endeavor to try to open a new chapter in Indo-Pakistan relationship. Our objective at this meeting should be not recrimination over the past, but a new look towards the future.
भारत और पाकिस्तान ने ये बात मान ली कि वो एक दूसरे के अंदरूनी मामलों में दखल नहीं देंगे, अपनी अपनी फौजें वापस बुला लेंगे और पहले की तरह डिप्लोमेटिक, आर्थिक, सांस्कृतिक संबंध आपस में कायम रखेंगे. एक बार फिर अमन का दौर आया. भारत अपनी आर्थिक और सामाजिक समस्याओं से निपटने लगा. कश्मीर में फिर से चैन हो गया. तरक्की होने लगी. दो यूनिवर्सिटियां शुरू की गईं और जम्मू और कश्मीर में पोस्ट ग्रेजुएशन तक तालीम मुफ्त कर दी गई. पूरी रियासत में मेडिकल आसानियां भी आम कर दी गईं. आजादी के समय पूर्वी बंगाल पाकिस्तान का एक अहम हिस्सा था, जहां मुसलमान बहुमत में थे, जो नए हालात में तरक्की की बड़ी उम्मीद रखते थे. लेकिन पाकिस्तान के फौजी हुक्मरानों ने, जो पंजाबी थे, पाकिस्तान के एक इस्लामी हुकूमत होने के बावजूद भी बंगाल के आर्थिक मामलों पर ध्यान नहीं दिया, जहां से पाकिस्तान को रेवेन्यू का बहुत बड़ा हिस्सा मिलता था. पूर्वी पाकिस्तान के अवाम ने और पूर्वी पाकिस्तान के कुछ रोशन ख्याल लोगों ने भी आम चुनाव और जनता राज की जोरदार मांग की. यहां तक कि पाकिस्तान के राष्ट्रपति जनरल यहिया खां को आम चुनाव पर तैयार होना पड़ा और ये चुनाव 1970 में किए गए. शेख मुजीबुर रहमान की अवामी लीग ने पूरे पाकिस्तान की 169 सीट्स में से 167 पर चुनाव जीत लिया. राष्ट्रपति यहिया खान तो इस बात पर तैयार थे कि मुजीबुर रहमान पाकिस्तान के प्रधानमंत्री बना दिए जाएं, लेकिन फौजियों और पश्चिमी बंगाल के कुछ नेताओं ने एक बंगाली का प्रधानमंत्री होना मंजूर नहीं किया. ये थी इनकी इस्लामी एकता की एक मिसाल. 25 मार्च 1971 को नेशनल असेंबली बुलाने के बजाय, जैसा कि यहिया खान ने वादा किया था, मिलिट्री ने पूर्वी बंगाल में हिंसा का राज शुरू कर दिया. जनरल टिक्का खां वहां के मिलिट्री गवर्नर मुकर्रर कर दिए गए. राजनीति का चलन रोक दिया गया और अवामी लीग को गैर कानूनी ठहराया गया. शेख मुजीब जेल भेज दिए गए. जब अवाम पर जुल्म सितम जोरों शोर से हो रहा था, एक विदेशी कैमरामैन ने ये तस्वीरें खींच ली थी, जिनसे पता चलता है कि मिलिट्री इस्लामी नियमों के कितना विरुद्ध जा रही थी. पूर्वी पाकिस्तान की मिलिट्री ने कितने ही घर गिरा डाले, इबादतगाहों को भी उसने नहीं छोड़ा. मारधाड़ और कत्लों गारतगरी के कारण लाखों लोग वहां से भागकर भारत में पनाह लेने के लिए आए. भारतीय सरकार ने पूरी कोशिश की कि पूर्वी बंगाल और पाकिस्तान के झगड़े का हल भी निकल आए और ये 1 करोड़ शरणार्थी भी पूर्वी बंगाल वापस चले जाएं, जिनके कारण भारत की आर्थिक समस्याएं पेचीदा हो गई थी। जब वहां की मिलिट्री की धांधली बढ़ती ही चली गई तो जनता ने बगावत कर दी और भारत से मदद मांगी। जो कुछ वहां हो रहा था उससे दुनिया का ध्यान हटाने के लिए पाकिस्तान ने भारत पर ही हमला कर दिया। भारत के कई हवाई अड्डों पर बमबारी की गई। भारत ने भी पाकिस्तानी फौजों को रोकने के लिए जवाबी कार्रवाई शुरू कर दी और पश्चिमी बंगाल में मुक्ति वाहिनी की मदद करने लगा, जो बांग्लादेश की आजादी के लिए लड़ रही थी। भारतीय फौजों ने 10 दिनों में पाकिस्तानी फौजों के कदम उखाड़ दिए। पूर्वी बंगाल की जनता ने भारतीय फौजों का शानदार स्वागत किया। दिसंबर 1971 को जनरल नियाजी ने हथियार डाल दिए। उसी के साथ भारत के तमाम मोर्चों पर जंग बंद कर देने का खुद ही ऐलान कर दिया। 97,000 फौजी कैदी बनाकर भारत लाए गए। जनेवा कन्वेंशन के नियमों के मुताबिक उनकी अच्छी देखरेख की गई, जिन पर बेहिसाब रुपया खर्च किया गया। आखिर वो बचे खुचे पाकिस्तान को लौटा दिए गए। जब बांग्लादेश आजाद हुआ तो पाकिस्तान उन 2 लाख बिहारी मुसलमानों को बुला लेने पर तैयार था, जो 1947 में बंगाल में बसने चले गए थे। पाकिस्तान ने आज तक अपने उन मुसलमान भाइयों को अपने यहाँ नहीं बुलाया। पूर्वी बंगाल में मिलिट्री ने आतंकवादियों का एक ग्रुप अल बद्र के नाम से बनाया था। जंग खत्म होने के बाद भी अल बद्र ने बहुत से बंगाली मुसलमान बुद्धिजीवियों को बेरहमी से कत्ल कर दिया। इतना जो कुछ हुआ उसमें हम सब के लिए यकीनन एक सबक है। पाकिस्तान ने बार बार इस्लाम और इस्लामी भाईचारे का नारा लगाकर जिनको अपनाया उन्हीं को आखिर में दगा दी। पाकिस्तान की इस हार से मिलिट्री राज को हटना पड़ा और सिविल हुकूमत ने बागडोर संभाली। जुलाई 1972 में मिस्टर जुल्फिकार अली भुट्टो और मिसेज इंदिरा गांधी की शिमला में मुलाकात हुई, ताकि वो एक ऐसे सुझाव पर गौर करें जिनसे दोनों मुल्कों की आने वाली नस्लें जंग से सुरक्षित रह सकें। शिमला पैक्ट के तहत भारत और पाकिस्तान ने तय किया कि सारे झगड़े आपसी बातचीत और शांति से निपटाएंगे। दोनों ने यह भी तय किया कि वो एक दूसरे की कौमी और इलाकाई एकता और खुद मुख्तारी का लिहाज करेंगे। इस समझौते से दोनों मुल्कों के आपसी संबंध खुशगवार होने की उम्मीद हो गई थी। जोर अमन और शांति पर था। आखिर कश्मीर की जनता को भी बड़ी उम्मीद बन गई कि अब वो अपनी तरक्की के काम बढ़ा सकेंगे। उन्होंने बुद्धिजीवियों की अपील पर बड़ा ध्यान दिया, जिसे कश्मीर के बहुत बड़े कवि महजूर ने यूं पेश किया है। आओ हम अपने झगड़े और गलत फहमियां भूल जाएं, आओ हम भाईचारे और सच्ची मोहब्बत को आम करें। अब एक बार और पाकिस्तान अपने वादों से फिर गया है, जिन्हें सारी दुनिया जानती है, और कश्मीर में फिर बेअमनी फैला रहा है। पाकिस्तान ने बार बार शिमला पैक्ट की खिलाफ वर्जी की है, जिस पर राष्ट्रपति भुट्टो ने दस्तखत किए थे और पक्का वादा किया था कि भारत के अंदरूनी मामलों में दखल नहीं दिया जाएगा। हाल ही में कश्मीर और दूसरे राज्यों में शहरियों को अगवा किया गया और उन्हें मार डाला गया। इन मुस्लिम बुद्धिजीवियों का कत्ल कश्मीर के उन नेताओं के इशारे पर हुआ जो समंदर पार मुल्कों में रहते हैं और जिन्होंने कबूल किया है कि पाकिस्तानी आतंकवादियों की ट्रेनिंग के लिए अड्डे मौजूद हैं। इन खतरनाक हालात में कर्फ्यू लागू करना ही पड़ा, ताकि आम आदमी की जान और माल सुरक्षित रह सके, क्योंकि हमेशा ऐसे हालात में पाकिस्तान की धांधलियों के कारण आम आदमी और उसका परिवार ही मारा जाता है। आपने देखा किस तरह पाकिस्तान ने इस्लाम की दुहाई देकर कश्मीर को हथियाना चाहा और किस तरह इस्लाम के नाम पर मुसलमान कबायलियों और पाकिस्तानी फौज ने अपने कश्मीरी मुसलमान भाइयों पर हर तरह का जुल्म किया, जबकि इस्लाम ऐसी हरकतें हरगिज नहीं सिखाता। सिर्फ कश्मीर ही नहीं, आगे चलकर पाकिस्तान ने पूर्वी बंगाल के साथ भी यही सुलूक किया। क्या पूर्वी बंगाल पाकिस्तान का प्रदेश नहीं था? क्या पूर्वी बंगाल निवासी मुसलमान नहीं थे? आज सिंध में क्या हो रहा है? भारत से गए हुए मुसलमान मुहाजिर कहलाते हैं, क्या वो मुसलमान नहीं है? उन्हें पाकिस्तानी क्यों नहीं समझा जाता? इस्लाम की दुहाई देना और इस्लाम के खिलाफ अमल करना कहां तक जायज है? इस्लाम के नाम पर जुल्म और जंग पाकिस्तान की आदत बन गई है। बांग्लादेश की जंग के समय पाकिस्तान की ओर से जुल्फिकार अली भुट्टो ने यूनाइटेड नेशंस में ऐलान किया था कि पाकिस्तान भारत से 1000 साल लड़ सकता है, और उनकी बेटी पाकिस्तान की भूतपूर्व प्रधानमंत्री श्रीमती बेनजीर भुट्टो भी यही कह रही थी। और तो और, पाकिस्तानी फौज के एक जनरल ने भी यही रट लगाई हुई थी, जिस पर भारत के चीफ ऑफ आर्मी स्टाफ जनरल रॉड्रिक्स को जवाब देना ही पड़ा कि 1000 साल तो क्या, पाकिस्तान भारत से 1000 घंटे भी जंग न कर पाएगा।
फिर भी भारत इस बात पर जोर दे रहा है कि कश्मीर का फैसला जंग से नहीं बल्कि शांति से हो, और इसके लिए हमारे भूतपूर्व प्रधानमंत्री ने 3 प्रस्ताव रखे थे।
कश्मीर पॉलिसी elements very clearly which have been spelled out to those in charge and they are expected to implement it. One, the message has to go to specialist forces and external forces that they cannot succeed. Two, the human agony at the same time has to be taken care of. Because ultimately, it is the involvement of the people of Kashmir that will bring in the final solution. Number three, the human rights angle has to be kept in mind. Now it is established fact that Pakistan is training terrorists and sending them across the border, is fomenting sessionism, but we are competent to take care of problems that come across the border.
याद है मौलाना अबुल कलाम आजाद जैसे काबिल, दूरंदेश और मुसलमानों के सबसे बड़े हमदर्द नेता ने मुल्क के बंटवारे के फौरन बाद भारतीय मुसलमानों को क्या मशवरा दिया था? उन्होंने कहा था, आप मादरे वतन छोड़कर जा रहे हैं, आपने सोचा इसका अंजाम क्या होगा? आपके इस तरह फरार होते रहने से हिंदुस्तान में बसने वाले मुसलमान कमजोर हो जाएंगे, और एक वक्त ऐसा भी आ सकता है जब पाकिस्तान के इलाकाई बाशिंदे अपनी अपनी जुदागाना हैसियतों का दावा लेकर उठ खड़े हों। बंगाली, पंजाबी, सिंधी, बलोच और पठान खुद को मुस्तकिल कौमें करार देने लगे। क्या इस वक्त आपकी पोजीशन पाकिस्तान में बिन बुलाए मेहमान की तरह नाजुक और बेकसाना नहीं रह जाएगी? हिंदू आपका मजहबी मुखालिफ तो हो सकता है, कौमी और वतनी मुखालिफ नहीं। आप इस सूरत हाल से तो निपट सकते हैं, मगर पाकिस्तान में आपको किसी वक्त भी قومی اور وطنی مخالفتوں کا سامنا کرنا پڑ جائے گا جس کے آگے آپ بے بس ہو جائیں گے صرف اتنا ہی نہیں اکتوبر سن 1947 میں انہوں نے اپنی جامع مسجد والی مشہور تقریر میں ایک بار پھر کہا تھا میں کہتا ہوں کہ جو اجلے نقش و نگار تمہیں اس ہندوستان میں ماضی کی یادگار کے طور پر نظر آ رہے ہیں وہ تمہارا ہی قافلہ تھا انہیں بھلاؤ نہیں انہیں چھوڑو نہیں ان کے وارث بن کر رہو اور سمجھ لو کہ اگر تم بھاگنے کے لیے تیار نہیں تو پھر تمہیں کوئی طاقت بھگا نہیں سکتی آؤ عہد کرو کہ یہ ملک ہمارا ہے ہم اس کے لیے ہیں اور اس کی تقدیر کے بنیادی فیصلے ہماری آواز کے بغیر ادھورے رہیں گے